أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد والثناء لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين ولعنة الله على أعدائهم ومنكر فضائلهم من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. السلام عليكم my dear brothers and sisters ورحمة الله وبركاته. It's an honor and a privilege to be spending this evening with you, continuing our discussion on the commentary of Surah Al-An'am. If you remember in our first session, we mentioned that Surah Al-An'am is a unique surah in that it was one of the last surahs of the Holy Quran revealed in Mecca. It's considered to be a late Meccan surah. And therefore it was a surah that was revealed when the Muslim community was demoralized, they were overcome by their enemies, the future of Islam was very bleak. And therefore you find that this surah is essentially meant and intended to raise the morale of the Holy Prophet and the Muslim community. And we mentioned that there are traditions of the Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam that highlight that this surah was actually revealed jumlatan. It was revealed at one time. All 165 verses of Surah Al-An'am were revealed to the heart of the Holy Prophet in one instance, at one time, and it was escorted to the Holy Prophet by 70,000 angels along with Jibra'il alayhi salam. We discussed the first verse in our last session where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Alhamdulillah alladhi khalaq as-samawati wal-ard wa ja'ala adh-dhulumati wan-nur thumma alladhina kafaru birabbihim ya'dilun. We spoke about the meaning of hamd, and we mentioned that the first verse gives us one of the reasons why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one who is deserving of our praise and our deep gratitude. It's because He is the one who created the heavens and the earth. And we spoke about that in elaborate detail. Now, tonight, inshallah, we'll try to cover 2 through 5. Now, let me bring your attention to ayah number 2, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُم مِّن طِين ثُمَّ قَضَى أَجَلًا وَأَجَلٌ مُسَمَّا عِنْدَهُ ثُمَّ أَنْتُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, it is He who created you from mud, then decreed a time and a specified time known to Him, yet still you doubt. When you look at the Holy Quran, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the creation of Adam, there are over a dozen ayat in the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that He created Adam from tin, from mud. Now, because Adam alayhi salam is the father of modern man, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He speaks about our creation, because we are an extension of Adam, He mentions to us that He created us from tin. Now, when you scan the Holy Quran and you look at the verses where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the physical creation of man, you find that there are different descriptions that are given. And to the untrained eye, to a beginner who's studying the Quran, many of these verses seem contradictory. And what I mean by that is the following. For example, if you look at Surah Ali Imran, ayah number 59, and I'd like you to make note of these ayat so you can refer back to them, because many critics of the Holy Quran, they point to these verses and they say, look, the Quran is contradicting itself. In one verse, Allah says, He created Adam from this material. And then in another verse, Allah mentions a different base material. So in Surah Ali Imran, ayah 59, Allah says, إِنَّ مَثَلَ عِيسَى عِنْدَ اللَّهِ كَمَثَلِ آدَمَ خَلَقَهُ مِن تُرَابٍ ثُمَّ قَالَ لَهُ كُنْ فَيَكُونَ. The similar, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says the example of Isa is similar to the example of Adam. He created him from dust and he said to him, be, and he was. So in this ayah, Allah says he created Adam from turab. In surah, in ayah number 2 of surah Al-An'am, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that he created the human being from teen, from mud. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again in surah 38, verse 71, Allah says, إِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي خَالِقٌ بَشَرًا مِنْ طِينٍ. And when your Lord said to the assembly of angels, I am creating a human being from mud. Again, similar to ayah 2 of Surah Al-An'am. In Surah Safat, Surah 37, verse 11, Allah gives another description of the creation of man. Allah says, Inna khalaqnahum min teenin lazib. Allah says, and indeed we created them, we created the human race from a sticky mud. In another ayah of the Quran, you find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Anbiya, Surah 21, ayah number 30, mentions a different material that he created man from. Allah says, وَجَعَلْنَا مِنَ الْمَاءِ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ حَيٍّ أَفَلَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. Allah says, and indeed we have made all living things from water. Will they not believe? Surah 15, ayah 28, Surah Al-Hijr. Allah gives another description of the creation of man. وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي خَالِقٌ بَشَرًا مِنْ صَلْصَالٍ مِنْ حَمَئٍ مَسْنُونَ. Allah says, and we said to the angels, I am creating a human being from potter's clay, from dried, darkened clay. So one ayah says Allah created man from teen. Another ayah says Allah created man from turab. Another verse says Allah created all living things from water. And some verses Allah references clay as the base material, the base ingredient for the creation of man. And then Allah, in other verses, he speaks about darkened, dry clay. Are these verses three? The ulama say, and inshallah, I'll share with you an excerpt from Nahjul Balagha where the Imam, where Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam speaks about the creation of Adam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he speaks about the creation of Adam, he's speaking about different stages of his physical creation. The base source for the creation of man in the Holy Quran is what? Water and dust. Ma and turab. These are the two main base sources or the two main ingredients for the creation of man. When you combine water with turab, because turab in Arabic is, it's dust, it's dry soil. And water, we know water. When you combine the two, when you combine water with turab, what do you get? You get teen. You get teen. And when you add more moisture, you get what? Teen ul lazib. Sticky mud. And the Quran obviously is not using scientific terms. The Quran is using terminology that is understandable even to those who are not familiar with the science of biology or chemistry. When teen is exposed to, when it is dried, it is called salsal, like the clay. And when the clay is exposed to heat, it becomes what? Hama'in masnoon. It becomes very dry and darkened. So these verses where Allah mentions teen and he mentions turab, and he mentions ma, and he mentions salsal, and hama'im masnoon, these are not contradictory verses. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning the different stages that the physical creation of Adam went through. And therefore, I want to bring you at the first khutbah of Nahjul Balagha. As many of you know, Nahjul Balagha is a collection, not of all of Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen's sermons, but the sermons that have literary merit. Al-Sharif al-Radhi, he gathers excerpts or entire sermons where he finds them to be exceptionally eloquent. So Nahjul Balagha is not all of the sermons that Amir al-Mu'mineen delivered. They are the sermons that have exquisite beauty, that have literary merit. In the first sermon of Nahjul Balagha, there is a section called Sifatu Khalq Adam, a description of the creation of Adam. And I'll read for you the Arabic and I'll translate it, and inshallah, it will be very consistent with the explanation that I gave. Amir al-Mu'mineen, Salamullahi alayhi, he says, with respect to the creation of Adam, he says, ثُمَّ جَمَعَ سُبْحَانَ مِنْ حَزْنِ الْأَرْضِ وَسَهْلِهَا. Allah, when he created Adam, he gathered hard earth and soft earth. وَعَذْبِهَا وَسَبْخِهَا. He gathered earth that was sweet and earth that was salty. تُرْبَةً سَنَّهَا بِالْمَا. This earth that was gathered, dipped it in water. حَتَّى خَلَصَتْ. Until it became pure, Amir al-Mu'mineen says. وَلَاطَهَا بِالْبَلَّ حَتَّى لَزُبَتْ. And Amir al-Mu'mineen says, more moisture was applied until it became sticky. It's exactly how the Quran mentions. طِينُ اللَّازِبْ. فَجَبَلَ مِنْهَا صُورَةً ذَاتَ أَحْنَا. And Allah carved from this material an image. وَوُصُولٍ وَعَضَاءٍ. An image that had limbs and joints and segments. فَجَبَلَ مِنْهَا صُورَةً ذَاتَ أَحْنَاءٍ وَوُصُولٍ وَأَعْضَاءٍ وَفُصُولٍ أَجْمَدَهَا. So Amir al-Mu'mineen, he says, Allah collected the soil, and then he wet the soil with water, and it became teen. And Allah added moisture to the sticky and gluey. And then Allah carved out the image of Adam alayhi salam. أَجْمَدَهَا حَتَّى اسْتَمْسَكَتْ. Amir al-Mu'mineen says, this teen, this sticky mud, was then dried until it solidified. وَأَصْلَدَهَا حَتَّى صَلْصَلَتْ. It became dry. And again, the Imam is also using terminology that is understandable to those who don't have a scientific background. لِوَقْتٍ مَعْدُودٍ. This material dried for a period of time and for a known duration until the Imam says, ثُمَّ نَفَخَ فِيهَا مِنْ رُوحِ. And then Allah blew His spirit in to Adam. So you see that when you look at Nahjul Balagha, you find that the base material for the creation of man is water and turab. When they come together, they become teen. When moisture is added to the teen, it becomes teenun lazib, as described in the Quran, sticky mud. When it is dried, it becomes potter's clay, salsalin kalfakhar, as the Quran says. And when it is exposed to a heat source, it becomes hama'in masnoon. It becomes darkened clay. So this is with respect to the creation of Adam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-An'am, He begins by speaking about the creation of Al-Alam Al-Akbar, the macrocosmos. And then in ayah number 2, He speaks about Al-Alam Al-Asghar, the creation of the microcosmos, which is the human being. Because the human being in and of himself, he is a universe. He is a small scale universe. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that He is the only one who is worthy of praise and gratitude, because he is the one who created the heavens and the earth. He is the one who assigned darkness and light. He is the one who created you from tin. He created this magnificent creation from lifeless earth, this living, breathing, intelligent being from a lifeless source. And then what does Allah say? ثُمَّ قَضَى وَأَجَلٌ مُسَمَّنْ عِنْدَهُ ثُمَّ أَنْتُمْ تَمْتَرُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and then he assigned, and then he decreed a time. ثُمَّ قَضَى أَجَلًا, and then he decreed and a specified time only known to him. You notice in this ayah that the word ajal, which is a period of time, is mentioned twice. The word ajal is mentioned twice. Now why is that? Because the translation of the ayah is what? Then decreed a time and a specified time known only to him. Yet you still doubt. What is the meaning of these two times that are decreed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? There's a hadith where Humran, one of the students of Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, salawatullahi alayhi, Humran is the brother of Zurara ibn A'yan. Zurara is one of the famous students of the sixth Imam. Humran is the brother of Zurara. He asks the Imam about this ayah of the Quran. The hadith says, سَأَلْتُهُ عَنْ قَوْلِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. Humran says, I went to Imam al-Sadiq and I asked him about this ayah, specifically the part of the ayah where Allah says, ثُمَّ قَضَى أَجَلًا وَأَجَلٌ مُسَمَّنْ عِنْدَهُ. And then he decreed a time and a specified time known only to him. Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, he responds, and he says, Al-Musamma ma summiya li malik al-maut wa huwa alladhi qala Allahu fi fa idha jaa ajaluhum la yasta'khiruna sa'atan. Ajal is a reference to the lifespan of the human being. It basically means how long you will live. And this is something that is decreed by Allah. But there is an important point in this ayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that there is a time that has been decreed for man, an initial calculation of our lifespan. The first ajal that's mentioned in this ayah is that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates the human being, there is a capacity for that human being to live. For example, Allah may create someone, and this human being, in their environment, they can live anywhere between 60 years or 80 years. This is their ajal. They can live 60 to 80. But the actual lifespan is only known to Allah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates man, and he gives them a time interval, a lifespan. This person can live 60 to 80 years. But al-ajal al-musamma, the specified time that is only known to Allah, is the number that is given to malakul maut, which does not change. The initial ajal, the initial decree, is conditional. You can live 60 or you can live 80. There's about a 20-year interval. You, through your actions, you have a role in determining your own longevity. You're not going to live less than 60, and you're not going to live more than 80. Whether you're going to live 61, 75, or 80, your a'mal will dictate how long you will live or how short you will live. So Imam al-Sadiq, he says, this ajal musamma, this specified time known only to Allah, is the final verdict on your lifespan depending on the actions that you perform in your life. And this is what the Quran says in Surah Al-A'raf, Surah 7, verse 34. This is al-ajal al-musamma. فَإِذَا جَاءَ أَجَلُهُمْ. When their ajal comes, when their time comes, لَا يَسْتَأْخِرُونَ سَاعَةً. They are not delayed, nor time forward. It's a very precise time. This ajal al-musamma is precise. There's a hadith that says one man comes to Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq salawatullahi alayhi, and he asks the Imam, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, why is it that I see some people die with their eyes open and some die with their eyes closed? You may have seen people, when their soul leaves their body, some people have their eyes open and others, they depart this world with their eyes closed. He asks the Imam, what's the reason behind this? Imam al-Sadiq, salamullahi alayhi, he says, those who died with their eyes open were not given enough time to close them. And those who died with their eyes closed, Allah did not even give them enough time to blink and open their eyes. This is ajal musamma. This is the time for your death that is only known to Allah, that is revealed to Malakul Maut when it is time for you to leave this life. So the first ajal is that time interval. You can live 60 to 80 years. This is your ajal. But al-ajal al-musamma is the final verdict with respect to your lifespan. And you and I, we have a role. We can play a role in determining whether we live a long life or we live a relatively short life. There's a hadith where Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wassalam, he makes a dua. He says, A'udhu billahi min al-dhunub allati tu'ajjilu al-fana. O Allah, I seek refuge with you from the sins that hasten my death. Brothers and sisters, sins, they have consequences in the akhirah. We all know that. But Amir al-Mu'mineen, he says, sins also have consequences in this life. There are some sins that if you commit them, your life will be shortened. It has an effect on your longevity. So when one of the Khawarij heard Amir al-Mu'mineen say, O Allah, I seek refuge with you from the sins that shorten my life, one of the Khawarij asked the Imam, are there really sins that decrease the lifespan of the human being? The Imam alayhi salam, he says, Na'am waylak qati'atur rahim. One of the sins that shortens the life of the human being is severing ties with relatives. You may have siblings, you may have a cousin, you got into an argument with them, they gave you a dirty look and you stopped talking to them for weeks, for months, wal'iyadu billah, and sometimes even for years. Amir al-Mu'mineen says, doing this shortens your life. Your relatives, they have a right over you. It doesn't mean that you have to be best friends with them, but you're not allowed. It's a sin to cut off, to sever ties with relatives. You have to keep in touch with them, even if it's picking up the phone and saying salam to them. So Amir al-Mu'mineen says, one of the sins that shortens the life of the human being is qati'atul rahim. In another tradition from the Holy Prophet, and this shows you how much your life is decreased and shortened when you commit the sin of severing ties with family members and relatives. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, he says, إِنَّ الرَّجُلَ لَيَصِلُ رَحِمَهُ وَقَدْ بَقِيَ مِنْ عُمُرِهِ ثَلَاثْ سِنِينَ. Rasulullah says, there may be someone who was only going to live for 3 more years because they had severed ties with their family members. But because they reconnected with their relatives, فَيُصَيِّرُهَا اللَّهُ ثَلَاثِينَ سَنَةً. Allah prolongs their lives by 30 years. This person was going to die in 3 years because he had severed ties with his family and his relatives. He increase his life by 30 years. And then the Prophet says, on the flip side, conversely, there may be someone who had the ability to live for 30 years. They were maintaining ties with their relatives, and then they decided to sever ties. Allah decreases that 30 years to 3 years. So we have to pay attention, brothers and sisters, to these types of sins. So this is an ayah where Allah is speaking about ajr, the time that He has decreed, our lifespan. And there are certain actions that increase our lifespan, and there are certain sins that shorten the lifespan of the human being. Thumma antum, continuing the ayah, the end of ayah number 2, thumma antum tamtarun, and then you still doubt. If you look at the end of this ayah and you compare it with the end of ayah number 1, think of the first ayah of Surah Al-An'am. The first ayah was what? ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ يَعْدِلُونَ. And then those who reject and deny their Lord, يَعْدِلُونَ. They what? They set up equals to Allah. The end of ayah number 1, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking about the kuffar in third person. Here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking to them directly, second person. Let me give you a simple example. If there is a teacher who is standing in front of his class, and he says, and there is one student who failed the exam. He gave an exam, and one student failed. Sometimes the teacher failed the exam. In this case, he's speaking about the student in third person. A student failed the exam. And if this teacher wants to be more harsh, what does he say? You failed the exam. In ayah number 1, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is blaming the disbelievers, but He's blaming them in third person. In ayah number 2, Allah is a bit more harsh. He's blaming them directly. And yet you still doubt? You still doubt? Why does Allah end ayah number 2 in a more harsh tone than ayah number 1? The Mufassirin of the Quran, they say, perhaps it's because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may excuse you for being heedless with respect to the signs in the heavens, the creation of the heavens and the earth. But how can you be oblivious to the magnificence of your own creation? In ayah number 2, Allah is speaking about the creation of man. He's speaking about your creation. So you are more blameworthy when you turn a blind eye to the profound nature of your own creation. Whereas in ayah number 1, Allah is speaking about the signs that are external. You may be heedless with respect to the ayat that are external to you, but how can you be blind to the ayat that are within you? As Allah says in the Quran, سَنُرِيهِمْ آيَاتِنَا فِي الْآفَاقِ وَفِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَهُمْ أَنَّهُ الْحَقِّ. So in ayah number 2, Allah is more harsh because Allah is speaking about the creation of man, your own creation, which is the closest thing to you. There are other scholars, going back to this idea of ajal, as I said in ayah number 2, there are two ajals that are mentioned. ثُمَّ قَضَى أَجَلًا وَأَجَلٌ مُسَمَّنْ عِنْدَ. There are some Sunni scholars, and I just want to share with you the opinion of three scholars, and they all have the same opinion. Some scholars believe that the first ajal mentioned in ayah number 2 is a reference to the lifespan of the human being in this life, how long you're going to live. وَأَجَلٌ مُسَمَّنْ عِنْدَ, and the specified time known only to Allah Some of the Sunni Mufassirin, they say this is a reference to the moment where we stand before Allah on the Day of Judgment. Because that is a time only known to Allah. Only Allah knows when we will be resurrected and when we will stand in front of Him. And this is the opinion of Ibn Kathir and Tafsir al-Qur'an al-Azim. This is also the opinion of Qurtubi, and it's also the opinion of Tabari. Now, ayah number 3. وَهُوَ اللَّهُ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَفِي الْأَرْضِ يَعْلَمُ سِرَّكُمْ وَجَهْرَكُمْ وَيَعْلَمُ مَا تَكْسِبُونَ. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, He is God in the heavens and on the earth. He knows your secret and that which you make public, and He knows that which you earn. My dear brothers and sisters, this is the only ayah in the Quran. There are many verses in the Quran where Allah tells us that He knows what is in the heavens and the earth. There are many verses in the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that He is the owner of everything that is in the heavens and in the earth. But this is the only ayah in the Quran where Allah says, I am in the heavens and in the earth. هو الله في السماوات وفي الأرض. Ayah number 1 of Surah Al-An'am, Allah was telling us what? The underlying message of ayah number 1 is Allah's omnipotence. That Allah is the all-powerful. He created the heavens and the earth. He created light and darkness. Ayah number 2, again, a reference to Allah's power and His might, His omnipotence. He is the one who created this living, breathing, intelligent being from lifeless material. A reference to His omnipotence. Ayah number 3, the discussion shifts. Allah's omnipotence to Allah's omnipresence. First ayah, Allah is saying, I'm the all-powerful because I created the heavens and the earth. Ayah number 2, I am the all-powerful because I created man from a lifeless substance. Ayah number 3, Allah is telling us that He is everywhere. He is omnipresent. Other scholars of the Quran, commentators of the Quran, they say this is a reply and a rebuttal of polytheistic traditions that maintain that there is a God for every phenomenon that we see in nature. Like the ancient Romans used to believe there is a God for the rain. There is a God for fertility. There is a God for sustenance. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هُوَ اللَّهُ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ. He is Allah, the one who is in the heavens, who manages the affairs of the heavens. وَفِي الْأَرْضِ. And He is the one who manages the affairs of the earth. Because the ancient Arabs were of the belief that Allah only governs the heavens. And the idols are the intermediaries that govern the affairs of the earth. Allah says, no. هُوَ اللَّهُ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the sustainer of the heavens, and He is also the sustainer of the earth. But the dominant opinion seems to be that this is a reference to the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is omnipresent. He's everywhere. In fact, you find that in Surah Al-Mujadala 58, ayah number 7, there is a beautiful discussion about the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with us wherever we are. The ayah says, Surah 58, verse 7, أَلَمْ تَرَ أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَعْلَمُ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. Don't you see that Allah knows about everything that takes place in the heavens and the earth? مَا يَكُونُ مِن نَجْوَى ثَلَاثَةٍ إِلَّا هُوَ رَابِعُهُ. If there are whispers among 3, Allah is the fourth one who is listening. وَلَا خَمْسَةٍ إِلَّا هُوَ سَادِسُهُمْ. And if there are five who are whispering amongst themselves, you see five. Allah says, I'm the sixth who is listening. وَلَا أَدْنَى مِن ذَلِكَ وَلَا أَكْثَرُ. If there are less, Allah is with them. If there are more, Allah is with them. إِلَّا هُوَ مَعَهُمْ أَيْنَمَا كَانُوا. So in this verse, Allah is telling us, in verse number 3 of Surah Al-An'am, Allah is telling us that I am with you wherever you are, and I am also fully aware of what is happening. وَهُوَ اللَّهُ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَفِي الْأَرْضِ. Allah is present. But not only is He present, He is fully aware. Because sometimes a being may be present, but they're not aware. Have you seen someone who's in a coma? They're present, but they're not aware. And sometimes someone may be aware, but they're not present. You may know of what is happening on the other side of the world, but you're not physically there. Allah is saying, not only am I present, I'm also aware. And not only am I aware, I'm there, I'm present. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يَعْلَمُ سِرَّكُمْ وَجَهْرَكُمْ. Allah says, He knows your secret, and He knows that public. What does it mean when we say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what we keep secret? He knows our sir, He knows our secrets. The Mufassirin of the Quran, they say that the meaning of Allah knows what you keep secret, He knows your secrets, it means that He knows your intentions, He knows your thoughts. People can know of your actions. You may stand up for a salah, people see you praying, they can see your actions. But what is not visible to creation, what is unknown to people is what? Our intentions and our thoughts. So this is what Allah means when He says He knows your secret. He knows the motives behind our actions. He knows the intentions. He knows our thoughts. There's a beautiful line in Dua Kumail, and we recite Dua Kumail every Thursday, but some of us may miss a very beautiful, subtle point that Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam makes in Dua Kumail. In Dua Kumail, what do we say? We ask Allah at the end of the dua to give us the ultimate gift. What is this gift? And tahabali fi hadhihi al-layla wa fi hadhihi as-sa'a. I ask you, O Allah, to gift me on this night and in this hour, kulla jurmin ajramtu, to forgive me for every crime that I have committed. وَكُلَّ ذَنْبٍ أَذْنَبْتُ, and to pardon me for every sin I have committed. وَكُلَّ قَبِيحٍ أَسْرَرْتُ, and to forgive me for every ugly act that I have done in secret. وَكُلَّ جَهْلٍ عَمِلْتُ, and every ignorant action that I took part in. كَتَمْتُهُ أَوْ أَعْلَنْتُ, actions that I have done publicly or that I have concealed. أَخْفَيْتُهُ أَوْ أَظْهَرْتُ, and then the Imam, he continues and he says, and forgive me وَكُلَّ سَيِّئَةٍ أَمَرْتَ بِإِثْبَاتِهَا الْكِرَامَ الْكَاتِبِينَ. Oh Allah, forgive me for all of the sins that you commanded the noble scribes to record, the malaika that record our actions. Who are these noble scribes? الَّذِينَ وَكَّلْتَهُمْ بِحِفْظِ مَا يَكُونُ مِنِّي. Oh Allah, you have assign them the task of preserving all of my actions. وَجَعَلْتَهُمْ شُهُودًا عَلَيَّ مَعَ جَوَارِحِ, and you have made these two angels a witness over my actions in addition to my limbs. Your limbs are a witness to your actions, but you have a second level of witnesses, which are the angels. And then the Imam says, وَكُنْتَ أَنْتَ, you as a human being, your limbs are a witness over you. The angels are a witness over you. This is the second level of monitoring. And then you are saying in Dua Kumail that, oh Allah, You are a witness of all of us. You are a witness over the angels. You are a witness over our limbs. And then the Imam says, وَالشَّاهِدَ لِمَا خَفِيَ عَنْهُمْ. O Allah, and you are the witness over what has been concealed from the angels. The Malaika, they record your a'mal, but they do not know your intentions. When Amir al-Mu'mineen says, وَالشَّاهِدَ لِمَا خَفِيَ عَنْهُمْ, the Imam is referring to the secret that only Allah knows. The Malaika, they see you pray. They don't know your niyyah. They don't know your intention. There are hadith that say when you make a bad intention, there is a certain scent that is emitted in the spiritual world. If it's a pleasant scent, that means you had a good intention. If there is a foul scent, it means that you had an evil intention. But it's all knows the of our intentions, that knows our thoughts. وَالشَّاهِدَ لِهُمْ وَبِرَحْمَتِكَ أَخْفَيْتَ وَبِفَضْلِكَ سَتَرْتَ. So they are going back to the ayah. هُوَ اللَّهُ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَفِي الْأَرْضِ يَعْلَمُ سِرَّكُمْ وَجَهْرَكُمْ. Allah knows. He knows your secret, and he knows that which you make public. وَيَعْلَمُ مَا تَكْسِبُونَ. And he knows what you earn. Why does Allah add this last part of the ayah? If he knows your secret and he knows what you make public, what is the meaning of and he knows what you earn? The ulama, they say this idea of kasb refers to nata'ijul amal. Not only does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala know your intentions, not only does he know your actions, but Allah also knows about what those actions will entail in Alamul Akhir. He knows the corresponding reward or punishment of that action. You may see someone praying Salatul Layl. You know their action. And let's say that you're even able to know their intention. But do you know the reward that they have earned? We don't know. Even the Malaika, there are many angels, there are many ahadith that tell us that the Malaika, there are some good deeds that they're not able to calculate the reward of it. So the angels may know that the human being is performing an action, but they do not know what they earned because of that action. So Allah knows what we keep secret. He knows about the actions that we make public, and he knows what we earn when we perform actions, whether it's punishment or reward. وَيَعْلَمُ مَا تَكْسِبُونَ. Ayah number 4. وَمَا تَأْتِيهِمْ مِنْ آيَةٍ مِنْ آيَاتِ رَبِّهِمْ إِلَّا كَانُوا عَنْهَا مُعْرِضِينَ. Never did a sign from among the signs of their Lord come to them, but that they turned away from it. You have to bear in mind that Rasulullah is listening to this ayah, the Muslim community, the fragile Muslim community is listening to this ayah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is consoling them, telling them that essentially the problems and the opposition that you're facing is not something that's new. Is rejecting or denying the signs. The nations that came before you, it's the same story. History is repeating itself. What you're going through is not anything that is new. Never did a sign from among the signs of their Lord come to them, but that they turned away from it. And Allah, many times in the Quran, he reiterates this idea that the people of the past ages used to receive messages. When Allah says the ayat were delivered to them, it means that the truth was thoroughly delivered to them in a way that was very clear, and yet they rejected. They turned away. Mu'ridin here means that they turned away, not even interested in listening to the truth. And then in ayah number 5, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَقَدْ كَذَّبُوا بِالْحَقِّ. They indeed denied the truth. لَمَّا جَاءَهُمْ فَسَوْفَ يَأْتِيهِمْ أَنْبَاءُ مَا كَانُوا بِهِ يَسْتَهْزِيُونَ. They indeed denied the truth when it came to them, but tidings will soon come to them of that which they used to mock. If you look at ayah number 4 and ayah number 5, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaking about Quraysh, and he's speaking about all of those past nations that rejected the truth when the truth came to them. And it's interesting, Allah mentions 3 stages of kufr in these 2 verses. Because rejection of truth has stages. It's a gradual process. There are 3 stages of kufr that are mentioned in these 2 verses, verses 4 and 5. The first is marhalatul i'rad, as ayah number 4 ends with. Illa kanu anha mu'ridin. This is the stage of dismissal. There are some people, when the truth is brought to them, when the messengers and the prophets invite them, they're so engrossed in this worldly life that they're not interested. It's not that they reject, because they haven't even given the prophets an opportunity to fully explain and elaborate and to go into details about the content and their missions. So here at this level, they're just not interested. So there is no rejection yet. They're just not willing to even listen to the message. This is marhalatul i'rad, the stage of showing lack of interest, turning away. Then, ayah number 5, what does Allah say? فَقَدْ كَذَّبُوا. The kufr escalates. It goes from dismissed from a lack of interest to what? Rejection. Marhalatu takdhib, the stage of rejection. This is when they have understood the message. At the first level, they're not willing. At the second level, they have listened to the message and they reject it. The truth has been presented to them and they have rejected it. This is the second level of kufr. And then the final level of kufr is what? Marhalatul istihza, the stage of mockery. And this is what Allah mentions at the end of ayah number 5. فَسَوْفَ يَأْتِيهِمْ أَنْبَاءُ مَا كَانُوا بِهِ يَسْتَهْزِئُونَ. So the first level is marhalatul i'rad. The second level is marhalatul takdhib. And the final level is marhalatul istihza, which is the stage of mockery. Now, why is mockery the most severe of the stages? The first stage, you're hurting yourself. You're not willing to listen to the message. You're turning away. The second stage, you're also hurting yourself. But you're more liable because now you've heard the truth, because you can only reject it after you hear it. You've heard the truth and you reject. Marhalatul istihza is the most dangerous, because now you're mocking, and not only are you turning away from the truth, you are turning other people away from the truth. You are becoming an obstacle for others to see the truth because of your mockery. This is marhalatul istihza, and this is usually when Allah's punishment descends. This is usually when Allah says, this is the straw that breaks the camel's back. This is when divine punishment descends upon communities, when they reach marhalatul istihza. And there is a Quranic principle, and we'll end here, because the next verses require some in-depth discussion. There's a Quranic principle in Surah Al-Isra, ayah number 15. And this is, you know, a question that many people have. Is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala going to send all of these non-Muslims to Jahannam because they're not Muslims? Allah gives us an important Quranic principle. Surah 17, ayah 15. وَمَا كُنَّا مُعَذِّبِينَ حَتَّى نَبْعَثَ رَسُولًا. Allah says, we do not punish until we send a messenger. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't punish people unless they have rejected the truth. Unless the truth has been explained to them in a way that they've understood it. And if they reject it and they reach marhalatul istihza, they begin to mock the truth and prevent others from hearing the truth. This is when Allah's punishment descends upon them. Inshallah, ayah number 6, we will discuss it next week. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina wa nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala ahli baytihi at-tayyibin at-tahirin. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. It's now almost 8:45, so we'll leave about 15 minutes for Q&A, inshallah.
So I have a question in regards to, you had mentioned he knows our, Allah knows our secrets and that he's aware of your intentions. So I was just curious if you know of any dua or way that we can, like sometimes you have a good intention, you've got, like you want to carry out a good action, but sometimes it gets polluted by satanic thoughts or ways that will pollute our mind. So do you have a way that we could kind of just keep our intentions pure and for it not to go astray?
You know, the best remedy is actually found in the Quran. You know, and satanic whispers are so dangerous to our spiritual development that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed an entire surah to us. What do we say in Surah An'aam? قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ ملك الناس إله الناس من شر الوسواس الخناس. Look at the danger of waswasa, that we seek refuge with Allah 3 times. We don't just say قل أعوذ برب الناس من شر الوسواس الخناس. We say قل أعوذ برب الناس, say I seek refuge with the Lord of humanity. قل أعوذ برب الناس إله الناس, the God of humanity. ملك الناس, the King of humanity. من شر الوسواس الخناس. So reciting Surah An-Nas regularly is a powerful deterrent for this waswasa and these satanic whispers that could potentially pollute our intentions.
Okay, and say if you have that good intention and it like it starts getting polluted and you recite the surah, but would you still get guna for the bad intentions that are coming into your mind? Would you still get like guna on those or guna on
that? No. There are hadith say that if someone makes an evil intention but it doesn't materialize into action, there is no sin that is recorded. But on the other hand, if someone has a good intention, but it doesn't materialize into an action, Allah rewards you for that pure intention. So pure intentions are rewarded even if they don't turn into action, they don't translate into action. And evil intentions are not recorded as sins provided that they don't translate into action. And my recommendation is that if you feel that your intentions are becoming polluted and they're not for the sake of Allah, don't keep performing that action. So for example, if you're offering prayers and you notice that between Salatul Maghrib and Salatul Isha, everyone is standing up and they're doing Salatul Ghufayla, which is a good deed. But you know that the only reason you're going to get up is because you feel embarrassed and you want people to think that you're a religious person. If this thought comes into your mind, sit down and don't do Salatul Ghufayla. Don't do it. It's better for you not to do it. Catch yourself and tell yourself that I'm not going to do this good deed just so people can praise me. I know that my niyyah is not pure. I'm going to wait until I correct my niyyah and then I'll... Is it clear? So basically, doing no action is better than doing a good deed with a polluted intention. It's better for you to do nothing.
Assalamualaikum, Maulana. I have a question. You say that the deeds or the thinking even have some positive and negative effect in the soul, right? So what are those things? If somebody is thinking negatively and positively, I know from scientifically we understand that his deeds, if he's not even doing it, he has a very negative effect. But yeah, what's the Islamic thought about if what the soul could be impacted by just thinking negatively or positively?
Can you repeat the question? I didn't understand the question.
Well, Anna, my question is, you said in your speech that every act has a, thinking has an impact on the soul. So even a person don't perform anything, but if he think negatively or positively, it can have an impact. So what are those impacts, or what is Islamic thinking about it?
Now, of course, you know, there's a lengthy discussion among the ulama about whether involuntary actions have an impact on the soul or not. There are some scholars that say only committing sins, consciously committing sin, has an impact on the soul. Whereas if someone accidentally, for example, commits a sin, there's no damage on the soul because no sin was committed. So this is a lengthy discussion among the ulama. Some say that willful sinning is what causes damage to the soul. If someone accidentally commits a sin, without having this azima, without willfully doing it, there's no damage done to the soul. And there's a different school of thought that says, no, even if someone inadvertently does something that's against the sharia, like, for example, consuming something haram by accident, it's still going to have an effect on the soul. So if you're from that school of thought, even thoughts that you don't have control over could negatively impact the soul, while others say, no, it's only those conscious thoughts that have a negative impact on the soul. And this in and of itself requires an entire lecture.
Just shortly, Maulana, what are those impacts? Like, they are like what you can say, some punishment in will be an akhira, or they will be like what are those impacts?
Loss of tawfiq. That you might lose the tawfiq to do certain good deeds. Not necessarily that you're going to be punished. You may lose the opportunity or the tawfiq to do certain good deeds.
Assalamualaikum, Maulana.
Alaikum assalam.
So you said that when the society reaches a point of mockery, that when it starts mocking, that's when the punishment of Allah comes on the on that community.
Generally, that's
you would think that now, especially since 9/11, we are that state that religion has never been mocked so much. I think since Earth was created, so it's been mocked the most now, very openly, blatantly, in a very, I would say, demeaning way. So, and there is no punishment from Allah, right?
I would argue that the majority of mankind has not gone through marhalatu takdhib, the second stage, because in order to reject, the message has to be delivered. And for most people around the world, the Islam of Ahlul Bayt has not been presented to them. The Islam of Bani Umayyah, of Bani Abbas, the Islam of ISIS, this is what the world knows. So this mockery, unfortunately, it's a reaction to a distorted Islam that has reached the people. So I would argue that most people cannot be considered kuffar in this sense, because they haven't, the truth hasn't been delivered to them, you know, in a holistic way, and explain to them thoroughly for them to reject it. What they're rejecting is this adulterated, distorted version of Islam that emerged after the death of the Prophet. And even when Allah decides to punish, Allah also gives, you know, time for people to come back. Like with the community of Lut, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He didn't destroy them at night. He gave them until morning. Even a community as wicked as them, Allah gives them a window of time to come back, to do tawbah. And this window of time, it could be hours, it could be years, it could be decades, it could be centuries. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He knows when a community has reached the point of no return. When a community reaches the point of no return, that's when Allah punishes them. But Allah, in His infinite mercy, He always gives time. He always gives time, especially when we're dealing with communities, again, who haven't, you know, who haven't received the pure Islam of Ahlul Bayt. And unfortunately, many of us have not been, you know, positive ambassadors of Islam to the non-Muslim world. You know, a lot of the mockery that we see, a lot of it can be attributed to the fact that we are very un-Islamic in our conduct. We haven't been what Imam As-Sadiq describes as, you know, be an ornamentation for us. كُنُوا زَيْنًا لَنَا وَلَا تُكُونُوا شَيْنًا عَلَيْنَا. Be a source of pride and ornamentation for us, and do not be a source of shame and humiliation to us.
Assalamu alaikum, Alana. I have a question regarding the two connotations of the word ajal, the time. You mentioned the one is the time span, which has a range of time, and the other is a fixed time that Allah has decreed. Can you elaborate on it? If the second one is decreed and it's fixed, how it relates to the duration of the span in the first instance? Yeah.
It's a very good question. You know, someone may ask, if there is ajal musamma, what's the point of the first ajal? And the answer that has been given by many scholars is that the first ajal is there to remind you that you have a role in determining the span of your life. If the Quran tells us there is one ajal, there is a specified time for your death only known to Allah, it may not motivate us to do certain good deeds. So because we have a role, there are certain actions that can increase or decrease our lifespan, we're more motivated to do certain actions. So because we know that severing ties with our loved ones, with relatives, can decrease our lifespan, that knowledge alone will motivate us, will become an incentive for us to maintain ties with our relatives. So this ajal, this interval of time, this lifespan, this time, is essentially there to incentivize us to perform certain good deeds and to refrain from certain sins.
Assalamu alaikum. I have a question about the creation of mankind, of creation of Adam. You explained the verses. So what I would like to know is, what is your response, your Qur'ani response, to the ideology of the evolution, the Darwin's theory, which is accepted in most societies as an established ideology. So what is the response of Quran to that?
The beauty of the Quran is that the Quran doesn't confirm nor does it deny Darwinian evolution. You know, the Quran is not a book of science. The Quran is a book of guidance. And therefore Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala seldomly delves into these scientific matters. But there are verses in the Quran that seem to support the notion that before Adam, there were human-like creatures that roamed the earth. And the reason why we say that is because if you look at ayah number 30 from Surah Al-Baqarah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala declares to the assembly of angels, إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً, that I am appointing a khalifa, a representative on earth. The angels have a very interesting reaction. What do they say? They essentially protest. قَالُوا أَتَجْعَلُ فِيهَا مَنْ يُفْسِدُ فِيهَا وَيَسْفِكُ الدِّمَى. Are you going to place a representative on earth who will spread mischief, who will spill blood? Now, if Adam is the first man to roam the earth, why do the angels have this expectation of man? It seems that the angels had experience and they witnessed the actions of a creation that resembled Adam, that existed on earth before Adam, that used to spread mischief and used to spill blood, that was perhaps more barbaric in nature. And we have traditions from the Ahlul Bayt that say before Adam there were 1,000 Adams, meaning that Adam seems to be what we were, man, a human being whose intellect is more superior to his predecessors. So the general notion of evolution, that there were human-like organisms that roamed the earth before Adam, this is possible. But was there a link? Does Adam have parents? The Quran denies this. There is no link between this. There's no link between these human-like creatures that lived before Adam and Adam. Adam, according to the Quranic account, did not descend from a male and from a mother and a father. He seems to have his own avenue of coming into creation. So there's no link between Adam and, you know, primitive man. And science is always evolving. You know, I don't think that, you know, just because the scientific community today has a consensus that we descend from apes or chimpanzees, even if there's a consensus in the scientific community, in light of new research, that consensus can break. That consensus can break. So I think it's important for us to stick to the Quranic narrative. And you know, because the Quran seems to be very clear that Adam does not descend from any predecessors. He doesn't descend from primates. He came into being. How he came into being without a mother and a father, we don't know. We don't have the answers to that.
Assalamu alaikum. I would like to know, from the third stages of truth rejection, can you bring me examples from the Quran or even from the history, from people who did this, so that it's clearer for us? Thank you.
So if you look at marhalatul i'rad, being dismissive, I can't think of an example of marhalatul i'rad. But marhalatul i'rad is just, you know, people who are just so indulged in this worldly life that they don't feel like they're in need of guidance. So they don't even give the Messenger of Allah a chance to even, you know, to even invite them to Islam. Marhalatul takdib, as I mentioned, is, you know, those who hear the truth. You know, someone like Abu Lahab, Abu Sufyan, individuals who were presented the truth and who rejected it. Marhalatul istihza are, for example, the Quraysh, who after rejecting the truth, whenever caravans would arrive and descend upon Mecca from other regions, when Quran would be recited, they would clap and they would shout and they would tell people that this Muhammad is insane, he's a magician, he's possessed. This is marhalatul istihza, when they become an obstacle preventing others from hearing the truth. And I would have to, you know, look at certain historical accounts and maybe other verses in the Quran to give you better examples. But off of the top of my head, you know, that's what we see.
Assalamu alaikum, Maulana. There was a question from one of the sisters asking if there was a relation between the title of Imam Ali Abu Turab and the first 5 to 6 verses of Surah An'aam.
So Abu Turab, was a title that was given to Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam by the Holy Prophet. It's narrated that one day Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi visits Amir al-Mu'mineen and he finds that the Imam is laying on the ground. He was taking a nap during the day. And because the Imam alayhi salam, his dwelling was very simple, he lived a profoundly austere life, the Holy Prophet saw that there was some dust that had collected on the cheek of Amir al-Mu'mineen. And the Holy Prophet, when he saw the Imam alayhi salam living such a simple life, and he saw him taking a nap, the Holy Prophet, he wiped away the dust from the cheek of Amir al-Mu'mineen, and he said to him, he woke the Imam up, saying to him, "Qum ya Aba Turab," stand, O Abu Turab. Abu Turab literally means the father of the dust. Now, what's the relationship between that? And by the way, this actually becomes Amir al-Mu'mineen's favorite title that was ever given to him, this Abu Turab, because it's a name that it's the Imam's humility, and it was the Holy Prophet praising the simplicity and the humility of Amir al-Mu'mineen, and there's nothing more dear to Amir al-Mu'mineen's ears than hearing the Holy Prophet praise him. Now, there's a poet that says, he speaks about this name, Abu Turab, because Abu Turab literally means the father of dust. Adam was created from Turab, as we mentioned. And Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, even though he is the son of Adam biologically, spiritually, he's the father of Adam, because Amir al-Mu'mineen is spiritually more elevated than Adam. So what's the relationship between Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, this title, and these first five verses? There's no direct relationship, because the first five verses don't explicitly mention Turab. They mention Tin. So there's no direct relationship between the title Abu Turab and Amir al-Mu'mineen in the first five verses.
Manat, we, in behalf of all the people in the room, we thank you for your time and your effort in educating us and enlightening with the tafsir of the surah. And inshallah, we look forward to more sessions with you in the near future, inshallah.
My pleasure, and I apologize for taking too much of your time. You know, I ask Allah to accept the little that I offer, and I appreciate the attentiveness of all of you. And I see that some of the brothers and sisters are taking notes. That's always, people take the study of the Quran seriously. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you and make you the bearers and the teachers of the Holy Quran. Wa sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa alihi al-tahirin.